Blood Brothers Podcast, a Five Pillars production.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, my dear brothers, sisters, friends, and the foes out there. Welcome to another episode of the Blood Brothers Podcast with your host, Didi Hussein. Before I introduce today's esteemed and very special guest, I want to remind all you avid podcast listeners that you can find us on all major audio platforms if you search Blood Brothers Podcast. And of course, it goes without saying that I'd like you all to click and subscribe, comment and like this video. Today's guest is someone who I first saw when I was about 16 or 17 years old, when I attended my first pro-Palestine event. When he and his organizations and companions were there at this Muslim-led protest, they stood out. And they stood out because there was a conception that it was people that looked like him that were oppressing our brothers and sisters in Palestine. But as years went and as I became more aware of the various diverse views within the respective community where the guest comes from today, I realized this was indeed an ally and a friend of the Muslim community. And that is the esteemed Rabbi Elhanan Beck, the UK representative of the Neturai Carter movement. Rabbi Beck, salam. How are you?
Hello, thank you. Shalom aleikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Thank you for giving me your time. You seem to be a man who does not age. I'd be honest with you. Maybe the bit of white hair, but you are still the fresh, young-looking rabbi that I recall nearly 16 years ago.
Thank you.
Thank you to you for giving us your time today. I'm looking very forward to our conversation.
Thank you, thank you.
Rabbi Beck, I want to kick off today's podcast with some warm-up questions. Now, these questions will not necessarily be related to what we're going to be talking about, but it's just to kind of set the mood. But it's also to do with certain educational aspects or clarity regarding the Jewish religion or beliefs. I've got a set of questions that I'd like to ask you. And as I mentioned, to you off camera, I said that there are certain beliefs that Muslims have that we all agree upon. Five prayers, one God, all the holy scriptures, the Torah, the Bible, the Gospel, the Quran, angels, the day of judgment, health, etc., etc. There are certain things which there is no disagreement upon. It doesn't matter what kind of Muslim you are. I want to ask you some questions about the Jewish faith. And I'd like to hear whether there is a consensus on an issue, according to your understanding, or whether there is a difference. Does that make sense?
Yes.
First question. Is circumcision for all males an obligation for Jewish men?
Of course. This is one of the basics of the Jewish religion.
Is there a particular age in which it should be done within, or can...
Yes, it's written in the Torah, but 8 days old.
8 days old.
But if there are some issues, health issues, they push it for a few weeks. I mean,
okay,
it's necessary.
Now, I know that, of course, you know, sexual intimacy outside of marriage is sinful, of course. But within marriage, is sexual intimacy allowed for any other reason besides having children? It's for like pleasure.
Yes. What mean yes? That means if you go on a normal life, a normal way of life, man and wife, just one man to one wife, on a normal way, I mean, everybody comes over the age of 45, but you can't get there anymore, so you don't have to separate. You can go on your life normally.
Okay. So you can have sexual intimacy with your wife for pleasure, as opposed to just children?
Yes, yes, normal. I mean, if your wife is pregnant, yes, so
okay,
you don't have to separate.
Okay.
I mean, of course, you can go on your life normally.
Okay.
This is the way as God has created the world. In it's written in the Torah that God's created a man, a woman, stay in you, go in your life normally. Okay. If you leave a wonderful life, not go out of your area.
Okay. Now, obviously, for... is the practice of polygamy allowed in Judaism?
What's mean polygamy?
Can a man have more than one wife?
Originally, yes. Originally, you can see in the Torah that the father Abraham have two wives, and Jacob, yeah, they have four wives. But later on for about 1,000 years ago, there was many rabbis what they saw that it's not practically, it brings out much problems.
Okay.
So more by the Ashkenazic Jews, they can only marry one man with one wife. Mm. But the Sephardic Jews, they are still obligated, they still may have more than one wife. Today, the Sephardic Jews is more the Jews that living in the Muslim countries. More.
Okay.
They may have more, but of course that we are obligated to the law on the place where we live.
Of course.
That we have to keep the law. If the law is only one wife, then we are not allowed to break this law.
Okay. Do Jews believe in a Messiah?
Of course.
Okay. And of course, if he is not Jesus or Isa, who do you believe this Messiah is?
Really, we don't know. We don't know. There are much prophecies about Messiah.
Mm.
But I didn't say even if this will be a person who will live life is life today,
mm.
or a person who's already died and is will back come back. But however, there will be a Messiah. This is one of our basic beliefs. If somebody don't believe in Messiah, he's not considered as a Jew.
Okay.
Because we have 13 principles. The 12th principle is that there will come Messiah. But I must note to this, just to clarify very clearly. Really, this is should go in your interview, not in the beginning in the warm-up questions. But okay. If you touch already this,
it doesn't matter.
This question, I will try to explain.
Go on, go for it.
Many people asking us, what is the difference from the Zionist? The Zionists take over the land. You believe that Messiah will come? He will take over the land. So again, you will take over the land and throw away all the Palestinian people. So what's the difference?
Mm.
This is completely untrue. When you want to see what means Messiah, you have to look in the books of prophets. Everybody can make up a picture and say, this is Messiah, this is nothing. You have to look in the two books of prophets, then you will see what they describe, what means that Messiah. Messiah means, in our belief, that there will come a prophet and he will bring very much spiritual from heaven in the heart of people.
And he will rule by justice?
Of course. Again, there will be a new wall there. But I speak some before that.
Mm.
He will bring down much spiritual in the heart of people on the world. All people, not Jews, not non-Jews, not Gentiles. All the people of the world will recognize the same God. All the people of the world will serve the same God in harmony and peace. Not only between people will be peace, even between animals will also be peace. The lions will only eat grass. They will not eat each other. They will peace on the whole world. All the people will recognize the same God and serve the same God. All the heart of people will turn to God. We will all together serve the same God. We believe that the holiest place is the Holy Land. The holiest place is Jerusalem.
Mm.
The holiest place from Jerusalem is today what you call Al-Aqsa.
Al-Aqsa, Masjid Al-Aqsa.
We believe in that. And we believe it will come down at the temple. We will come to this point in 1 minute. But Messiah don't mean that when Messiah will come, we will be the king, you will be the slave, we will throw out all the people from Palestine, we will take over the land, we will kill all the people.
Mm.
Not this will be the image at all.
Mm.
All the people together, me and you, we will not be on two sides of the coin. We will be on the same side of the coin. We will both serve together in Jerusalem, together to serve the same God in peace and harmony. This is what our belief is in Messiah. Now we'll come to the point what I told you about the third temple, what many people ask you, believe in third temple, in which places it'll be? Oh, in the same place, Alaska. What's going on, Alaska? What will happen with Alaska? There's also something what we have to look in the books of the prophets. What means that, the third temple? When you look in the prayer book, we have a prayer, it's called Nachem. There it's written there that it will come down, the third temple built from fire from the heaven. It will come down a finished temple. So now you can ask a question, how people can go in a temple of fire? The answer is we don't know. We don't understand this. We don't know. But this is what's written in the books of the prophets. Okay. So what will happen, how it will happen, what's going to be in there? We don't know. But we can only see what is written there. It will be all the people together. There will be peace and harmony between all people. In all of us together will go up to serve the same God on this place in the third temple. How it will look, we don't know. We don't know what's going to be.
I pray to Allah that if we ever live to see that time, that we get to see and we get to see that peace, love and security under the Messiah, inshallah. Ameen. Are there, so for example, Muslim men, generally speaking, they have to be covered from the belly to the knee. Yeah, there's other positions that say just the private parts, but generally it's the knee to the belly. For women, the mainstream is the mainstream position is headscarf and one single piece of garment. There's others that believe in the niqab. Others believe you have to wear gloves. Yeah, but the mainstream minimum is hijab, full scarf, one single outer garment. Yeah, is there a similar requirement for Jewish women and men?
Yes, there is a similar requirement, but exactly, it's not exactly in this way. I mean, of course, the woman should be covered. Look, the law as it is, they just have to be covered the hair. And of course, from here, they have to be covered the whole body, but not the hands.
Okay.
The hands starting from here, they can be open, the hands from here. The, all of them should be covered. Exactly the way how to be covered, there is many ways, and it depends in many countries where the Jewish people live. But this is the mainly for women, they have to be covered. Men also should be covered, but not so strictly at,
of course,
as women. So men usually they have to be covered like me. I'm covered also from here up and the only is open. But when I'm working, like I'm a plumber or something like that, I can be short sleeves and I can be short.
What about here? Can men wear shorts up to here?
Yes, they can, yes. If I'm working and I need for my work to be.
Okay.
Yes. But there is a minimum, of course, but I have to be covered. But but of course, the woman should be covered on any case. They can't uncover on the street, on any case, even not at home.
Are you concerned with the direction of how many Western societies are going where the nakedness of women, at least, is something that's promoted and encouraged as liberation and freedom and the way forward? Do you see the problematic nature in this, raising our daughters and our nieces and our sisters?
Give a look. The real way is the way of God, and this will survive, and this will succeed on every way. People will be happy. If they're following God, they will be happy. The other way, just look in the street how it looks like. Just look. Nobody is happy. They look happy, but they're empty.
Of course.
Completely empty. They are not happy. Happiness, you will find only people what are fair of God in the way that follows his way. The other people look at them, oh, the women are so covered. They are black. They are in such darkness.
Yeah.
But the reality is exactly, you can see, people what following God, they have happiness inside. They are happy with their life. They're happy to brought up the children. The houses is full of happiness. The man, the wife, the children, everybody is happy. Other people, They are empty, empty, empty. Nobody. They have every day. They have to see another videos, another videos, another videos. They have to do all this. What they're thinking? Maybe this will make happy. This will make happy. At the end of the day, such things cannot make people happy.
There's a huge.
Only bring them to darkness.
There's a huge void, isn't there? Emptiness.
Yes, and because of that, you have so much. Drug people and people, what they don't know what to do with their life. They're looking for some happiness and they can't reach it. The real happiness is when you follow God.
100%. What is the position of Ishmael in the Jewish tradition? Or what we say Ismail, the brother of Ishaq, Isaac.
I mean, when you look in the Torah, is Abraham have two sons, Ishaq and Ishmael. And when you look in the Torah, it's written there that God promised a land for Abraham, for Yitzchak, and for Isaac. And for Ishmael, he gives money, other properties, and other land. And not only for Ishmael, he have another six sons, Abraham from the same wife. He have two wives, Sarah and Hagar. Hagar is the mother of
Sarah
Ishmael.
Sarah and Hagar, yeah.
Yes. Hagar is the mother of Ishmael, and later she has remarried Abraham, or not remarried, maybe she only go away and she come back, and have another six children. And Abraham gave them properties and other things. But the promise of the Holy Land, there was for Yitzchak. And I come also to the point what really it belongs to the interview, not in the beginning, but when we're speaking about the promise of the land, we know that the Zionist waving every time, the promised land, the promised land, the promised land. But the same thing that took out things of the right meanings. The promised land, it's true, when you look in the Torah, that God promised the land for the Jewish people, for Abraham, Yitzchak, and Isaac and their children. But it was only promised under certain conditions. If you keep a high moral of life, as you can see, it's more than, at least, what I remember now, it's 36 times in the Torah, it's written that if we will not keep the high level of life, we will be exiled of the land. One of them is in Kriyat Shema. Kriyat Shema is the part what we say every time, every day, a few daily. We have to say it in our prayers. There is written in the in Kriyat Shema, V'hoyem Shemoya, it's written, Hishamru lochem, penyifta levavchem, v'satem, avadatem, v'chili, v'chu af Hashem bochem, v'utzer es Hashemayim, v'avadatem heiru ma'alu et satoivu. That means that if you will not keep the high level of life, you will be exiled of the land. Now, when you look in the books of the prophets, Yirmiyahu, Ezekiel, Yeshayahu, you see that God sent prophets to warn Jews to repent, to come back. If not, you will get exiled. Yirmiyahu was in the time of the exile, when the Babylonians came in there. We believe, and it's very clear in the Torah, that we were not exiled because we were weak. When you look in the Talmud, you will see Jews was very strong at that time.
So we believe that under Prophet Solomon and David, this was the golden era. In our tradition.
Yes, yes, yes.
This is when they had kingdom and they had a state.
Yes, but after 400 years, Jewish people go down, 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 and God sent prophets. The last prophet in the time of the first temple was Yirmiyahu. So you look in his book, it's very clearly that the exile didn't happen because we were weak. This happened a punishment of God. We were exiled by God.
Because of disbelief, because of rejection, because of not living the good, godly life?
Yes, 100%. Mm. So, again, the Zionists say the promised land, but they ignore the other part. The same, not person, God is not a person. The same God what promised us the land, he took it away from us. And he besworn us with three oaths not to go back to the Holy Land, just stay in exile waiting for the coming of Messiah. So this is only because he touched the promise of the land.
And we will get to that.
Yes.
And we're coming to the end of the quick fire questions, and I'm very intrigued. What is the position of alcohol for Jews?
We are permitted by Jewish law to drink alcohol. However, you won't see, when I'm speaking about Jewish people, I'm speaking about religious Jews.
Religious Jews.
I don't speak about so-called secular Jews, and not such a thing. We touch later this point.
Of course.
And not such a thing, secular Jews. There is a secular or a Jew. You can choose one of this. There are not such a thing. Like, you can't say a secular Muslim.
100%.
Or is a Muslim or is secular.
I mean, you can call yourself that as much as you can call yourself, yes, a giraffe.
Yes.
But in practice, you cannot, yes, be secular or liberal or that in thinking whilst believing in God, the, yes, messengers on the final day.
100%. So, yeah, again, when I'm speaking about Jews,
you're talking about religious practicing
about
Jews.
About, yes. So these people, you never find them drunk in the streets. Never.
When was the last time you had a drink?
Pardon?
When was the last time you had a drink?
We drinking one time a year, by one festival, it's called Purim. One holiday, it's called Purim. That is the only day, usually, what we're drinking. Many people, what they are drinking, also another day in the year, it's called Simchas Torah.
Okay.
But beside of that, you will not find Jewish people normally. We may drink.
In weddings?
No. We're drinking, we can drink, maybe one cup, but yeah, not more.
Okay.
We never go out of control.
Okay.
Only in this one, or some people these 2 days. Mm. But also, you can see the difference between people what they are empty and people what they are full. People what they are full, when they're drinking, what comes out of them? That comes out how they're praying to God, in the singing to God, in the say, God, we're looking for you, we want to see. That's what is coming out. Mm. But the people what they're empty, what's coming when they're drunk, just go out in the night and in the city, you will see exactly. I didn't want to bring it on my mind.
No, but it's true though. It's true. Look, let's be honest, by where there is in societies where there is a high level of substance abuse, drugs, alcohol, it's because there is an emptiness in the people that are looking for something greater. Whether you worship God, you're going to worship something else. But your reason for worshiping is because that's part of how God created us and our father Adam. That's how you created them, to believe, to worship. Now, if you want to worship a footballer or a porn star or some wrong person, that's up to you. We worship God, yeah? And God has laws for us to,
yes,
follow. Yeah. So, next question. Are Jews allowed to marry non-Jews? So, for example, for Muslims, a Muslim man can marry a Christian woman and a Jewish woman. Not just any Christian Jewish woman, a practicing, God-fearing Christian and Jewish woman. But ideally, he should marry a Muslim woman. But if not, you can marry a Christian and a Jew. The children have to be Muslim. For the woman, she cannot marry. She can only marry Muslim men. What is the position in Judaism?
No, we are not allowed to marry not a man, not a woman from other religions.
Smashed it. Why not? Keep it in-house, innit? Keep it in-house. Why is Jewish lineage preserved from the mothers? Why?
I can't answer you.
Is this is it true?
Yes.
So forgive my language, you're not a real Jew unless your mom's a Jew. Is that what it is?
Not exactly. Because,
okay,
you have another way of conversion.
Okay.
But one of this, or you have all the mothers straight up till the Mount Sinai.
Okay.
Or you're converted. If you convert, you are the same as a Jew like everybody.
Okay. I'm glad you said that.
So there are many times what a Jewish man married a non-Jew, not to speak if he allowed or not, but he done that. And it comes to a later day and he want to come back to Judaism. Mm. Say, what's going to be with my children? So they can convert to Judaism.
Okay.
This comes to another point also, what people say, whatever people taking out from the Torah, what people want to say that Jews are a race. Judaism is not a race at all. Everybody can join that.
So it's not from the 12 tribes of Jacob?
Yes, but everybody can join Judaism.
Okay.
No difference, black, white, Chinese, Japanese, no difference.
I'm glad you said that.
Everybody what convert to Judaism is the same Jew like me. So exactly.
Perfect for my next question.
So this is really what people say, that Judaism is a race. We're basically, this completely unto Judaism is a religion. Like Islam is a religion. You can be a black Muslim, you can be a Japanese, a Chinese, no 100%. Difference. This is a religion. Judaism is a religion. This is not a race.
I'm so sorry. I'm sneezing away. I'm so sorry. I've been vaccinated. I've taken a test before seeing the rabbi chill, yeah? So, you know, you're talking about conversion.
Yes.
Alhamdulillah. I don't know what's going on. For people to convert to rabbi, you need to convey the message, right? So we know that Noah, Moses, Abraham, all the prophets from Adam alayhi salam, from our father Adam, for us to Muhammad, for the Christians to Jesus, and to the Jews, who was your last prophet?
It's not only one. Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, three prophets, what is described as the last one.
Okay, so all those prophets, they came with a message to their people. Worship the one God. Live according to God's law. Do not associate partners with him. Worship him alone and do good deeds. Now for us to win people over, so Muslims, we have to convey the message for people to become Muslim. The Christians do it. Why do we not see Jewish groups, generally speaking, conveying their message to win people over?
We haven't got the missionary system. The thing is, because it's hard to be a Jew. It's not so easy. We have 613 laws, and every law have sub-laws, I will say like that. And it's not so easy. And you can see that you will not see Jewish people. When I'm speaking about Jew, I'm speaking about practicing Jew. You won't see us in the government. You won't see us ministers or something like that. We may become a minister. We may do everything. But you will not see us at the end of the day.
But would you not invite people to your religion?
Why? Because this is very hard. Not only we are not invited. Even if somebody come to say, I want to become a Jew, we try to tell them, look, why you have to do that? Stay as you are. You have to keep the seven laws of Noah, and you will have your part on the other world. It's no problem. God don't ask you to be Jewish. But if he wants to, why we do that? Because from Judaism is no way back, according to the Jewish law.
Of course, same with Muslim. If you become Muslim, if you become
a Jew,
خلاص.
Even you think, oh, I want to go back. Yeah. But when you come on the other world, they will say, you're obligated to keep all the Jewish laws.
So Rabbi, you know, you said that committing or converting to Judaism is a huge commitment because there's so many laws and it's not easy being a Jew. Those are your words. So what I'm asking you is, if there was a Jewish government who ruled by the Torah's law and someone became a Jew and then they decided one day, I no longer want to be a Jew, is there a punishment for them?
Yeah, well, look, there is one law for an original Jew and for a converted Jew.
Ah.
There's no difference between them at all.
Okay.
So again, the punishment what it will be for somebody what converted is the same as the punishment what I will get. If, what is that? You have to learn the whole Torah. I mean, the money punishments of money sins. You're speaking about going away. At that time when Jews was in the Holy Land, I don't think there was such a thing, because they were stopped much, much before. Much before they're going away at all. For each sin, what they have their own punishment. I mean, so people has been stopped much, much before they're going away. So what the punishment is, you have to learn the whole laws. I mean, the whole Torah to learn.
Okay.
The Torah, the Talmud. But what you're asking before, why we haven't got a missionary system?
Yeah.
This is simple because in the Jewish law, there are no way back from Judaism. And it's hard to be Jewish. So why people should punished for nothing? We didn't want somebody to join Judaism only if he's really, really very serious. So when somebody come to a rabbi, they want to convert, the rabbi told them, why? It's good like that.
Okay,
so you can keep the seven laws, God will be happy from you.
So my
you
next
don't become Jewish.
So my next question is then, are you then saying that a non-Jew, okay, because these two questions are connected. So do you believe in a heaven and a hell?
Of course.
So can a Gentile or a non-Jew go to heaven?
Of course.
How?
If he keeps the seven laws of Noah.
What are the seven laws of Noah?
Oh.
Is it long or is it quite...
No, it's seven laws, but I didn't remember all now. But
okay, so if he believes in the seven laws of Noah...
In the practicing that,
okay.
Of course he will get his part in heaven.
Okay, I can maybe understand. Maybe we need Rabbi Yusuf here, isn't it? Rabbi Yusuf would be a good addition here. Rabbi Yusuf is the lovely man who's, you know, a friend of Rabbi Bex, who's given us his home today to film. I can understand from that standpoint that, okay, a Muslim or a Christian will probably practice or believe in Noah's seven laws. Maybe. Because there is this overlap in the tradition. The origin goes to Judaism.
As far as I know, the seven laws is included in the Muslim... And also in
But Rabbi, what do we do about, like, Hindus and people who worship idols and multiple gods?
Give a look.
You're smiling because you know what the sketch is, innit?
I don't like to comment.
No. Okay, fine. Next question. Okay. My final question. What is the position of interest in Judaism? So, Rabbi Beck, I need to borrow £1,000. Dili, no problem. You have 1 month to pay me. If not after 1 month, I charge you £100 every month. This in our is called riba. Usury. It's haram for us. It's not allowed. Is it allowed for Judaism?
It's not allowed within the Jewish community. But it is allowed outside the Jewish community. Because...
Gunshots.
You have to understand that. Very, very simple. In the Jewish community, nobody takes... Not I from you, not from you from me. Nobody takes that. However, outside the Jewish community, we deal with families, with networks. They're taking interest for me.
Mm.
It's very normal that I can make business with them on their way while they're walking.
Okay.
But within Jewish community, we're not allowed to take ribis. We call ribis that.
Yeah. So riba is not allowed internally. Externally, you can shaft the man, yeah?
We can do... business as usual.
Okay, fair enough. That is the end of the quickfire questions. How did you find it?
Very good.
I liked it. I enjoyed it. I learned a lot. Let's kick off what was supposed to be the crux of the conversation, but I guess it's now kind of linked to what we spoke about. When I asked you the question about the Messiah, you very passionately explained that the Messiah will be someone who will come with a godly, higher moral order. There will be peace and love within mankind, between animals and so forth. And you also said that the promised land that the Jews were promised by God will come at the time of the Messiah or at the hands of the Messiah. Yeah?
Messiah will only be a prophet. He will not do nothing. He will be a holy man, a prophet.
Will he not be a leader of a state or a civilization?
He will be the prophet. I'm not sure. Could be. He will be the leader.
A king or... Like Solomon and David were both kings and prophets, were they not?
Yes. What we are describing, the whole concept of Messiah, the Promised Land, is completely a different concept.
Okay, fine, the Holy Land, okay.
I tried to give you example, yes? People were saying, oh, Messiah, the Promised Land, he will take over the world. So, describe Messiah as a powerful man with arms. He will say, he will have a loud voice, and he will say, in our description, when you describe Messiah, look in the Talmud, Messiah is described as a poor man coming on a white donkey. I don't know what it means. The same, but I don't know what it means, a tear temple from fire coming down. Okay. Yes. But how is the description of Messiah? A poor man coming on a donkey. Mm. That's all this description of Messiah will look like. He will not take over by power. He will take over by spiritual, what he bring in straight into the heart of people. He will turn the heart of people to God. Not to him. Mm. Not to him. To God. The heart of all people to God. This will happen when Messiah will come. So it's completely not... it's not power. It's not a concept of power.
So when can Jews go back to the promised land and have a state?
When Messiah will come, all the people will go back. Look, in my belief, yes, I'm a Jew, you are a Muslim, let's say he's a Christian. Yes, I mean, everybody have his own belief.
Of course.
You believe that everybody will become Muslims.
Yes.
At the end, he believed that everybody will become Christians. Yeah. We believe that everybody will become Jews. So, of course, in my belief, that everybody will become a Jew, but not by power. Messiah will bring into your heart spiritual to tear into the Jewish way of life. Mm. So me and you will be on the same side of the fence. And we will serve the same God with own heart together. We will have no difference between us. This is what I believe is.
What is the religious objection then, at least for your organization, what is the religious objection to the state of Israel?
Look, when you look at this question, you have to first understand what is a Jew. We spoke already about it.
Yes.
Judaism is a religion. It's not a race. You can be a black, a Chinese, a Japanese, no difference. Judaism is the religion. If you keep the religion, you are a Jew. If not, you are not a Jew. Again, no difference. If you keep the religion, means not only keeping, you have to convert.
Can I ask you something quickly? So if, let's say there is a girl called Hannah, yeah? If her mom, all her moms
up to the Mount Sinai were
Jews, but she says that I do not believe in the God of Moses, I do not believe in the God of Abraham, I do not believe in a God, is she still a Jew?
Yes and no. What means yes and no?
Okay.
I told you before that there's not such a thing to go away from Judaism. So that means she have the obligation for the whole Jewish religion, but she's not counted as a Jew. As only if she believes at least in the Tretton principles. If somebody believes in Tretton principles, even we're not keeping the religion, he's a Jew what do sins. He's a sinning Jew, but he's still a Jew. But if somebody don't believe even in one of these Tretton principles, then he is not counted as a Jew.
He's
not counted as a Jew. But, however, there is something what calls Yisrael af pishachutu Yisraeli. That means a Jew remain a Jew. What means remains? He remains a Jew that he's obligated to keep the Jewish religion. So this is also one of the subjects what the Zionists try to confuse people. Mm. A Jew remains a Jew. Yes, this is only for the obligation. But he's not counting as a Jew. Completely not.
Okay. So what, then I go back to what is the main religious objection to the state of Israel? What is the objection?
Oh, sorry.
No, it's
in the
fine.
Middle of that. Yes.
No, it's fine. We've got
so again, a Jew means somebody what keeps the religion. Somebody what not keeps the religion is not a Jew. So Judaism is a religion. Zionism tried, let's go one step back. You can understand that from every religion, Jews, Christians, Muslims, I don't know, Islam, anything, the main thing is that you believe God, you trust in God, you have the full trust in God. Judaism, yes, you can understand as a religion, that means that if you have the full trust in God, and always He can answer with us. Believing God don't means only when God gives you sweets. Even in the bad times, you don't lost you believe in God. This is a Jew. If you believe only in God when He sweets you, doesn't mean He believes. That means you leave the sweet. You don't believe in God. You believe in the sweet. So the basic of a Jew is trust in God in the good times and even in the dark times. We have the full trust in God that everything has been done by God, and everything what is due is for our favorite, 100%. Even when you're speaking about the Holocaust, by the way, killed 6 million of Jews. Very bad, it's terrible. I mean, you don't find such a thing in the history, at least not in the Jewish history. You find it, you know where? But Zionists.
Yeah.
They're killing Jews, but not physically, but spiritually, much more than 6 million. However, let's go back to the point. There was very bad what's happened by the Holocaust. But also, we believe that everything has been done by God, not by Hitler. Hitler was only a messenger. He will get punished for his deeds because he has a free choice. He can choose to do good and to do not good.
But what you're saying is the event itself was decreed by God.
Yes, 100%.
It's in the same way that we believe as Muslims, all good and bad comes from Allah.
And the
outcome. And there's a reason and a wisdom for it, which we will never know. Only 100%. God knows.
Now, people ask me, what? You are crazy. Look, 6 million Jews. What's going on? They go in the guest chambers. What good is that? The answer is, you're going sometimes to the hospital, a doctor makes you an operation. Sometimes it's painful. What do you do after that? You tell for the doctor, thank you, and you pay him money. What's going on here? He causes you so much pain because you believe that the pain is for your favorite. You don't understand how a doctor working. You don't know how the electricity working. You don't know. You don't know how to make operations, but you believe in him. He is only a human soul. We believe in God. And we know that every operation what God do, every operation has been done by God. In every operation what is doing is for the favor of the person. So we have the full trust in God. Zionism, there has built up by, there's founded by secular people, like to the Herzl.
Theodor Herzl, yeah.
To the Herzl was completely secular. He don't believe in God, he don't keep the Torah. He didn't make even a circumcision for his son.
So why
and he was proud of that.
Oh, so why was Theodor Herzl, who's regarded as the founding father of Zionism, why was he so passionate about a state for the Jews then?
Today, Herzl looks of Jews with other eyes. He looks at Jews as a nation, not as a religion. Jews are as a nation. What's going on there? They're already 2,000 years in exile. Why can't? What we have to do? I mean, what will happen if the French will be in exile? What do they have to do? They have to organize themselves and take over a country. What's going on there? So he's a non-believer. No, our goal in life is not a state. Our goal in life is to serve God. Of course, it's easier if we have a state, but it's not our goal. Our goal is not this world even. Our goal is the other world. This is what we're looking for. Here we know we're coming here to work. So, but a person who don't believe in God, he looks at the situation completely with other eyes. What's going on here? Jewish people, as a nation, they are already nearly 2,000 years in exile. Why? Why they don't organize themselves? So this is what Theodor Herzl think. We have to organize Jewish people, take over a land. No difference if people leave there or not leave there. Don't put it for the side. We speak later about it. But take over a land. Be like an Englishman, like a Frenchman, like a Japanese, like a Chinese, like all the people in the world. Yes, this is when you look on people with other eyes. So now you can understand now what's the basic difference between Judaism and Zionism is. Judaism is when you look on this world like a preparation to the other world. When you look on God that he runs everything and you have the full trust of him, when he wants, he gives us a land. When he wants, he takes away the land from us. We don't lose our trust in God. Zionism is built up on the basic of a person who don't believe in God. And he looks with other eyes of people. He looks at people, Jewish people, like everybody. So why not organize yourself? So you can understand Zionism think how long we will be in exile. They don't believe that God sent us in exile. We've gone in exile because we are way weak. So of course, what we have to help ourselves, we have to organize ourselves and go take back a land. So this is the basic. Zionism is built up of non-believing in God, of not trusting God.
So why do they use the common argument? So even Netanyahu and his predecessors and Sharon and even those who predated him, they always used the language that this is the land promised to the Jews in Torah. That even recently, before Netanyahu lost the elections, he said that this is now a Jewish nation state for the Jewish people because it's promised to us in our scriptures.
I will ask you back. Netanyahu speaking about the promised land. He was a religious person? Completely not. Completely not. He don't believe in God. Who promised that? God if he don't believe it in God, if he don't believe in God, who promised the land? He was an unbeliever. He is an unbeliever, not only him. Most of the prime ministers of Israel, Sharon was an unbeliever.
Can I ask you, you know, when you say that they are non-believers, is that non-believers from the perspective of Neturai Kata, or there's many other Orthodox practicing Jews who will regard them as non-believers?
Everybody will say he's non-believer. Ask him himself. He will say, I'm a non-believer. He don't keep Shabbos. He eat pork. He have no problem with all this. He haven't got problem with the Jewish religion at all. Now that today's prime minister, he called Manette, he going a small kippah. Small kippah. I don't believe how much he believes, real. Mm. However, but Netanyahu, he never said that he believe in God. He just used the Torah to brainwash Jewish people and to terrorize the world.
Can I ask you something?
To wave the promised land. He himself don't believe in the promised land.
So many of the sad footages that comes from Palestine is of Jewish settlers who look like you, Rabbi.
Yes, unfortunately.
They look like you. That's why when I said to you, when I saw you when I was 17, I thought, why are they here? They look like the people that are oppressing my people. So how can you be a religious Jew and a Zionist at the same time?
It's really a contradiction.
But they exist.
They don't think.
But they exist.
Yes, they exist. They don't think.
Okay.
I'm sure that you have in Islam the same thing.
Yeah, we
people want to live in a contradiction.
Of course.
How they can be, they don't think. They don't think. Mm. Really, for about 100 years ago.
Do you have any family members who are Zionists?
Not really.
Okay.
No. There are not so many. They are about 10,000, 15,000, that's all. They are not so many, but they are very noisy. They're, for 100 years ago, Zionism started 125 years ago.
Yes.
So about 100 years ago, when Zionism becomes established a bit, still they haven't got a state. All the rabbis was against the state of Israel. All the rabbis, you can look in our website, www.nkusa.org.
Yes, the early...
nkusa.org. Look for the book. It's called 130 Rabbis. All the rabbis was against the state of Israel. Very, very small amount of rabbis were supported. The biggest of them was Rav Kook. Yeah. Rav Kook, he was supporting only his followers. They are the settlers. And today they're counting about 10,000-15,000 people while they are following him. And they are completely in a contradiction. Okay. They live in a contradiction. But it's impossible now to bring out the whole Torah and the whole Talmud to explain that.
So for our Muslim viewers, and listeners, and even non-Jew listeners that we have, just to kind of recap, the Jews were sent to exile by God because they were rebellious, they started becoming weaker in their belief, they weren't strong believers, maybe they were led astray from what God wanted them to do, and you believe that still should be the position of exile.
Not I believe, it's written very clearly in Talmud, in Ksubot, page 111, there's very clearly, God besworn Jewish people, not to go out of exile by force. Three oaths, not to go out of exile by force, not to rebellion against other nations, and not to go up en masse to the Holy Land.
Okay.
These three oaths what God gives, it's very clearly.
So, you know, Zionism was born at a time in Europe when nationalism as an ideology was on fire everywhere. You had the Balkans. You had nationalism problems within the Ottoman Caliphate. You had nationalism in the European colonies.
The British Empire.
Nationalism was the thing of the day. Are you saying that Zionism then was a distortion, a deviancy of nationalism, secularism, and picking and choosing the Jewish religion? Do you think
even not picking and Jewish? And even not picking some, they don't believe in nothing. They didn't want to pick anything. But they understand, to speak to the Jewish heart, you can't come with materialism. Does not speak to anybody. If you come with nationalism for people, I want to give you a state, nobody will listen to you.
So you need the language of the Holy Land.
Yeah, the Holy Land, they know that everybody have, every Jew have very strong ties to the Holy Land. Me, myself, I have very strong ties to the Holy Land.
You were born in?
Not of my birth. But these ties is spiritual ties.
There's
no difference who runs the land. Jews or Muslims or Turks or English, no difference. My ties are spiritual tie to the Holy Land. I can serve better God there. I'm closer to God there. I believe in that.
When was
I can't go up there now because the Zionists occupy the land.
When was the last time you went?
When I was a small child of 2 years, my family gone out.
Where were you born?
I born in Jerusalem.
You were born in Jerusalem?
I'm already 7 generations in Jerusalem. But my father was one of the big fighters against the state of Israel there, like you have there today. Hundreds of thousands of Jewish people what are fighting against the state of Israel, don't participate voting, they boycott the voting, they don't take any benefits from the state. My father was on many demonstrations, he was many times in prison. At the end of the day, he decided to go out. We don't want to live under the Zionist regime. You can't stay in a state where you are against them. This doesn't go together.
So do you just picking your brain, do you believe that if you or our friend Rabbi Yusuf or anyone from your organization, if you were to settle in Israel or occupied Palestine, do you see that as sinful? It's incorrect? You shouldn't be doing it?
No, it's not sinful when you go there as a private person.
Okay.
If I can live there exactly as I live in a Palestinian state,
yeah,
there is no problem. But if I touch anything to give them strongness, to give them power, oh, this is a sin. Okay. I have to keep away. And this is not easy.
Okay.
So again, we come back to the question: what you're asking. I didn't want to go one thing to the other.
Yeah, it happens. I asked you about Zionism, and I asked you about how can a religious Jew live in Israel? Or are they sinful?
Yeah, no, it's not sinful. A religious Jew can live there.
So can you believe that we should be in exile, but I'm still going to live in Israel?
I can live there,
yeah,
as long as I'm in exile there.
Okay.
When somebody lives there and he wants better a Palestinian government rather than the so-called Jewish government, yeah, he can live there as an individual.
Okay.
But in reality, it's very hard.
Okay.
It's very hard. It's very hard to brought up children on this way. I live in a state and I'm against it totally. They're full of contradictions.
Of course.
It's much better if you go out, but not everybody can go out. There are still there hundreds of thousands of Jewish people who are living there, and they are completely against the state of Israel. And they get beaten, they're going out on many demonstrations, and they're doing many things, like they don't want to go to army. Money, tens of thousands, but they choose better to go to prison rather than to go to the army.
Because they refuse conscription.
Yes.
Okay.
And they didn't want to save the army. They didn't want to help the state.
Now, when you say hundreds and thousands or many, many practicing Jews, are you saying this is people besides Neturei Karta and you're thinking other religious Jews?
Not Neturei Karta.
But there are many others.
Yes, I must explain. The Tui Karate, it's not an organization at all.
What is it?
It's not an organization. We haven't got members. We haven't got... You ask me if I'm a leader of the Tui Karate. We haven't got the leadership. The Tui Karate is a name. What people give for these people, what they're coming out to bring out the Jewish voice, the Torah voice regarding Zionism. So people give...
What does it translate to? What does Neturak...
The Tui Karate is a translation of guardians of the city.
Guardians
that
of the city.
That means people who are guardians of the Jewish city, not the city, physical city. That means of the religion.
Of the religion, of the Jewish way. So Neturai Karta, you're saying, is not an organization. It is a movement, a thinking, and it translates to the guardians of the city.
It's more, people give the name for these people but coming out on the streets to bring out... And really, what you told me, you see me in the street. Yes. What you see me in the street, it's 10% of our work.
What's the other 90%?
The other 90% is within the Jewish community to clarify people. We're giving out books and we're spreading books. And we're doing very much within
you're
the
doing,
Jewish community.
You're doing intra-Jewish missionary work. No, because for Muslims, we have two dawah. Dawah to the non-Muslims and dawah to the Muslims.
Yes.
So you are giving dawah to your people.
Yes, this is 90% of our work.
Okay.
Our rabbi is here speaking every week, weekly giving speeches for people. Because the Zionist is coming every time with other tricks, every time to confuse people. They find many people like the Western Wall and like the graves of our sages and something. Many, many things to confuse people, to take them in into the agenda. And our rabbi is... clarify, and I write down the speeches and I'm spreading that and many, many things what we try to doing to keep Jewish people to understand that Zionism is a contradiction to the Jewish religion completely. This is not only a contradiction, this is diametrically opposed to Judaism. That's to clarify, not to be confused by Zionists. And not only here, I mean, I work globally. I sent money stuff to even Australia, in Argentina, in France, and Vienna, everywhere where there's Jewish community. With also sometimes we send speakers there. And I mean, our work is very widely. People give for this, people give the name the Tui Karate. So we are not really an organization. Really, when you see people looks like me about this type of a person, I can say that most of them are anti-Zionist.
The ones, the Jews who look like you?
Yes. Most of them, you look in Stamford Hill, most of them are anti-Zionist. And I must say that the other 45%, let's say, they are non-Zionist. I mean, they have their own life, their own prayers, in their own studies, in their own businesses. The State of Israel don't take... A part of the life at all.
Have you ever spoken to a Zionist rabbi?
I spoke, yes, many times.
And do you have conversations in a brotherly way or is it heated?
I don't like that because I don't want to go in I don't know how to call that, just...
Argue.
Arguing, yes. So this is not the mind. This is who can speak louder... So, I'm not interested in that. I try to avoid it every time. I'm speaking to people who are looking for the truth.
Okay.
People who are interested in the truth. That's what I'm looking for, and that's what we're doing for.
Mm. I'm bringing the podcast to an end. I want to ask you just two more questions. You know, there is a lot of talk about the two-state solution. 1967 borders... 1973 borders. Once, many years ago, there was even a conversation about the 48 borders, all these different borders. Do you think
King David,
Camp David, the Oslo Accords, there's been many, many things. Do you believe that a two-state solution could be a meaningful solution for peace, or do you think this is just...
No, we will not believe in a two-state solution. We believe in a one-state solution, in the whole land should go back for the Palestinians from the river to the sea. And I will explain it. So, yeah, just looking
from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free.
Yeah, just looking for the Torah. Here, 1 second.
Mohsin, you following the rabbi?
I'm just looking for the door over here.
Am I in your way?
As long as the state of Israel is a rebellion against Almighty, I explained to you before, God sent us in exile. It's like you have a child. The child is bad. You told him, I punish you. Stay in the corner for 10 minutes. Okay, I don't want to speak in the mic because I won't go to prison. However, you say for the children, child, stay 10 minutes in he coming out. What means that?
He's rebelling.
Yes, I couldn't care less about you, about the punishment.
I reject your authority.
Yes, I do whatever I want. The same thing if God sent us in exile. If we're going out of exile by force, rebelling against Almighty.
So what is the argument against exile? Because that's the Zionist argument, isn't it? It's against exile.
Yes.
It's to say that we no longer need to be in exile.
Yes, yes,
that
yes.
God has given us his promise and this is our land and we will take it.
No, you make a mistake. The Zionists don't believe in God. They okay. don't believe in the promise.
Okay, they use the language. They use the language.
They use this
They use the language.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So, again, Zionism is a rebellion against Almighty. As long it is a rebellion against Almighty, it can't be succeed. It's written in the Torah. That's what I look for. I couldn't find it. In Numbers 14, verse 41. Remember this.
Yeah.
Numbers 14, verse 41. It's written in the Torah. Why you rebellion against God, you will not succeed. It's also a similar situation when Moses, when God say for the Jewish people to stay in the desert for 40 years. I don't know if you link.
No, we have this story.
Yes, before when they're going out of Egypt, so God punished them to stay in desert for 40 years. But there were Jewish people where they say, no, we're going out right now. In Moses, the prophet Moses say for the Jewish people, why do you rebel against God? You will not succeed.
Yeah.
And they have not succeeded, however. But this, what is said in the Torah, this is not only for that time, this is forever. A rebellion against God can't be succeed. The state of Israel will come to an end. And they should come to an end. We'll come later to that. We're looking for a peaceful end. Nobody looks for bloodshed.
Of course not.
However, but they will come to an end. So, of course, we are not supporting a two-state solution. A two-state means Jews have a land. This is a rebellion against Almighty. God sent us in exile. Forbid us to have a land. So no difference how big the land is. We are not allowed even to have 1 inch of a land. The land should go back for the Palestinians. And really, the state of Israel will come to an end. We pray for a peaceful end in a speedful end, but Amen. They will come to an end.
Amen.
So now, so really, this is our view that we support as Palestinian state from the river to the sea. Really, we didn't touch one point. We speak only about religion the whole time. We didn't touch the point what has been done for the Palestinian people here.
Do you know why? the reason why I wanted to focus on the religious themes, Rabbi, is because, look, you and I might know its politics. The masses will...
Think that's a religion thing.
Religion thing. You can't. The flag of Israel is the Star of David. The settlers who are killing shepherds in the West Bank, they look like you. So I need to tell my viewers and listeners that look at what the religion is saying. Look what the rabbi is saying. That's why. Or else I know Zionism is a religion, is an ideology that was founded by secular, godless people. I know this. I know that it was born at a time where everyone wanted a state. I know that Theodor Herzl was a disbelieving Jew. I know all this. But our viewers and listeners, many will equate the two.
So I will ask them a question. If this situation, why? When you come in real Jewish areas, as more religious the people are, and more they keep away from Zionism. Like, look, here in Stamford Hill, but not only Stamford Hill, go in Manchester. Go in Gateshead, go in New York, yes, in Muncie, in the mountains. I can give you examples of very, very many Jewish areas, look in Australia, look in Argentina. As wherever you see people like me, you won't see the Israeli flag. You won't see that. Look with your own eyes. Why is that? If it's a religion, think. So we, real religious people, should be the first things to go in front. Why we keep away? This is completely the opposite. This is completely against the religion. But they managed to confuse a few religious people. This is the settlers.
So just
or the living in contradiction.
So just to give you that opportunity then to explain briefly then, if it's not a religious issue, it's a political issue.
Yes.
So what is the political issue with Zionism? That it is a political ideology, not a religious ideology. And it uses religious language to justify its politics.
I don't know if you know, today Herzl, one of his plans, before he think about the Holy Land, is speaking about to take a place in Uganda.
Oh, of course, Uganda. Yeah.
Yes.
But
he didn't understand what's wrong with it. But then come a few people, what they understand, and they say, I'm sorry, if you go to Uganda, you will be keep away. You will completely gone away from Judaism. Yeah. Nobody will follow you.
Yeah.
You can't take the people of Uganda. Nobody will be following you.
Yeah.
Because they try to confuse people with Jewish holy things. Okay. Just to confusing people of that.
So you stand by the position that Zionism as an ideology is godless, secular, irreligious, and it represents everything that goes against Judaism, the faith.
100%.
So I will conclude in my final question to you.
Yes. But do I have another thing to say.
Please say it. Final question. No, please say it. And then I will ask you the final question.
I tell you, I mean, Zionism say that they want to save Jews. Okay, it's not right, it's right. But Jews are in exile, Jews are being killed. Look what's happened with the Holocaust. We want to save Jews. We need to have a state. A state will save Jews. So this argument, what do you say to that? I mean, what I say to that is, first thing, I mean, we are not lost. We are in the hands of God. Even though that everything has been done by God. The Zionists don't believe in God. So it comes up the problem, it comes up the solution. But now, just give a look at this solution. The so-called solution. They say they want to save Jews. Let's just give a look if the state of Israel is saving Jews or not. The state, give a look today's day, the two facts. Jews live all over the world. They live peaceful. They have no problem anywhere to live. The only danger place for Jews, not to speak for Palestinians, the most danger place for Jews today is in the state of Israel. Every day another killing, every day another bomb. If you see if somebody see a person take out a bag to the dustbin, he call the police, maybe it's a bomb. It's crazy. You can't live like that. You can't live like that. It's such a terror. Such as a...
paranoid.
Yes. Look, I live here in England already 35 years. I don't know how an English soldier looks like. I never saw an English soldier. But in Israel, a small child of 3 years, no tanks, with soldiers, with guns, with all types of weapons, the whole life, going military, everybody. This is crazy. This is not a way of life. A materialistic life. Don't speak about religion. This is crazy. This is a safe haven for Jewish people. This is the most dangerous place for Jewish people. They say they want to save Jews. Look, since the Second World War, the Holocaust, anti-Semitism goes out of fashion. If any politician say even one word looks like anti-Semitism, we have to apologize. But look what's happened now with Jeremy Corbyn.
Of course.
Crazy.
Jeremy Corbyn.
I know Jeremy Corbyn. Many years. He have no problem with Jews. He's very good friend with me. Very good friend. Not only with me, with many Jewish people. He have no problem with Jews. He say even one word the Zionist make. So again, I come back to the point. Anti-Semitism gone out of question, gone out of fashion. Who raising anti-Semitism today?
Zionism.
They making raising anti-Semitism. Everybody told me, look in the TV, look what you people doing for the Palestinian children. They're raising up the anti-Semitism. They're saving Jews. They put us in the biggest danger what they can. What they can. They can't protect themselves and they won't protect the Jews all over the world. That's crazy. They can't protect themselves. It's the most dangerous country of the world. It's not normal. But I want to come to another point.
Please do.
One of the biggest propagandas, what they justify themselves is, Jews and Muslims can't live together. The Muslims want to kill all the Jews. They want to throw all the Jews into the sea. So on. This is the propaganda.
This is not true. We had many opportunities throughout history to do it. We never did it.
Yes, yes. So that's what I bring out. Mm. But this is the propaganda, the false propaganda what they're using. Yeah. The same what they're using, the Jewish holy things, propaganda for their own state, for the materialistic, nationalistic state. They're using the religion and everything. The same thing they're using, false propaganda. The Muslims, the Palestinians want to throw all the Jews into the sea. This false propaganda, they're trying to confuse people to stay on their side. Even you don't think like me, you don't think I'm right, but you must come on my side. Practically, you must come on my side. If not, you will be killed. This is completely untrue. Jews have a golden history in the Muslim countries for centuries, for centuries. Jews live in the Muslim countries much better than the rest of the world.
Iraq, 100%. Andalus, Ottoman.
Everybody that knows history a bit knows the best times for Jews was in the Muslim countries. And even today, Jews live in Iran, Iraq, Morocco. Myself was in Morocco.
Turkey as well.
Yes, I was in Morocco. I come to Morocco straight when I go to the border.
They have Jewish quarters.
Yes, I come over the border. The Muslim people come straight. Oh, please, Rabbi, bless my children.
Mm.
Where the hatred? Where is that? I didn't see it. Mm. In Algeria, in Tunis, in all the Muslim countries, Jews live peacefully. My father was in Iran a few times. There's a beautiful Jewish community there. They have their own MP. Even to get an MP in Iran, I think the rate is 500,000 people you need for MP. Mm. The Jews have, for 30,000 Jews, they have their own MP. Mm. And they have a beautiful life. They have no problem. All the Muslims... I told you, I'm 7 generations in Palestine. Yes, my mother told me, she remember, we used to live in the Palestinian neighbors in such a good relationship. We used to babysit each other, the children. In the Jewish holidays, they bring over the children to the Muslim neighbors. In the Muslim ones, they bring over the children to Jewish neighbors. We have no problem. The problem here is not the religion. The problem is occupation, killing, take away the land from people. This is the problem. The problem completely. The Palestinians don't hate Jews. They hate occupiers.
Occupiers.
No difference if it's a Jew, if it's a French, is English. No difference. The same hate they will have if the Japanese will come into the Holy Land and take it over. And the same thing will happen here in England if somebody comes to take it
100%.
Over. This haven't got nothing, but the Zionists tried to... No, this is anti-Semitism. No, no, no. This is the old anti-Semitism. This is completely untrue. It's completely untrue, and we have to bring this to the attention to know the problem is not the religion. The problem is the occupation. And I see that myself coming sometimes to demonstrations. And there are sometimes hot demonstrations. And they see a Jew... And they get anger. Yeah. But when they hear what I have to say, oh, not this I mean. I'm against the occupier, not against the Jew.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, we are best friends with Jew. They have no problem with Jew at all. So this is the comment, really what I have to say. And also another thing, what I told you before, that the State of Israel will come to an end at the end because a rebellion against God can't be succeed. It's also just look at the true fact. The State of Israel is already 74 years. How many countries has been established in these times? Tens, at least.
Hundreds.
Very many. Everybody have peace. The only place you haven't got peace is in the State of Israel. Why? It is the finger of God. They will never have peace. And they will come to an end. We hope and pray for a peaceful end. Nobody looks for bloodshed. But they will come to an end.
Inshallah, inshallah.
I told you, I born in Palestine. I gone out. I want to go back. I'm waiting for my Palestinian passport. and I will get Inshallah. It. I told for the Palestinian ambassador here in England.
Yeah.
I'm Palestinian Jew. I want a passport. He told me, one of the first passports, it will be for you. It will be a honor for us to give a passport for Jewish people
Inshallah.
To demonstrate they have no problem with Jews. We have a problem with occupiers.
Rabbi Beck, my last question was actually going to be that you've been praying for a peaceful end to the state of Israel. But the reality is that with the level of violence that's been meted out against the Palestinians, that there's naturally going to be armed resistance. Palestinians who have seen their fathers, their mothers, their grandparents killed, slaughtered like animals, yeah? And naturally these young boys will grow up to want to fight the occupiers. Do you believe the Palestinians have a right to defend themselves of the against the occupier?
It's two things what you're asking. They have the right to get back their own lands. But I can't justify violence on any case.
Okay. We all want an end to the occupation in a way which preserves the most amount of lives. That's everyone.
Yeah, but I must tell you, it's not so dark like you see that.
Mm.
I must tell you that even all the killings, in all that what's happened, both parties, Fatah and Hamas, declared very openly many times they have no problem with peaceful Jews. As long as they haven't got political aspirations,
yes.
They can leave there. Yes. So there is a way, a peaceful way. To say, if the American government will invest 10% of the money, what they invest now in the state of Israel,
yeah.
They invest only 10% to bring a peaceful end, they will find a way. Only with 10% of this money.
But they won't do that.
No.
They need Israel there to be their watchful eye in the region.
Yes, but however, I want to come to the other point. It's not so dark, the situation. I will give you an example. I don't know how old you are, if you remember.
33.
You don't remember it. And in what's happened on when the USSR has disappeared.
1989, the Wall of China.
I remember that.
The Wall of Berlin.
Everybody, not the Wall of Berlin, when the USSR has been disappeared.
Yeah, 1989.
For 30 years
yes,
ago.
Yes,
yes. Yes. I remember it. If anybody would remember the power of the USSR, they think the USSR to disappear, it will cost millions of lives, at least hundreds of thousands. Impossible. It didn't cost nothing, even a single life.
Hmm.
A single life.
Hmm.
Take another example, what's happened in South Africa.
With Mandela.
I also didn't remember, it was before my times.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, but everybody who remembers that, he thinks it will be their bloodshed. It was a bloodshed, but not far away what people imagine. So,
a peaceful resolution, yes, is possible.
Today's day, it's a liberal world more, and people don't look for bloodshed. People look more on the future. Okay, give me back the land from today. It's my, okay, fine, that's all. I understand the bad feelings, but it's not so dark as you look like. It could be a peaceful solution.
Well, we hope and pray for that, inshallah.
We hope and pray for that, and the most thing, soon.
Soon. And I pray that we both get to live to see that time.
Yes.
From the river to the sea, inshallah. Rabbi Beck, it was an absolute honor having you on. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
I must apologize if I asked you any questions that were disrespectful. I'm very,
very
sorry.
Good. Very good.
But
questions.
I thoroughly enjoyed our conversation. I would shake your hands, but as you can see, I've been sneezing. I wish you all the best, and I hope we can have you on again. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, man.
Brothers and sisters, I hope you all enjoyed this podcast as much as I did. I learned so much from Rabbi Beck, things that I assumed were the position of his people and things which I didn't know. And it was very refreshing and beneficial for today's podcast. Please remember to like this video, to share it, to leave a comment, and of course subscribe to the Five Pillars YouTube channel. And of course, for all the avid fans and listeners, you can find us, the Blood Brothers podcast, on all the major audio platforms. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brothers Podcast, a Five Pillars production.